Hello and welcome to the newspapers. This is the show where we look at the regionals around the country, from Belfast to Brighton. My name is Mike Mendoza and I'm joined week by week by Dominic Ponsford from the Press Gazette to discuss in detail the stories hitting the headlines in the regions around the whole of the country. Welcome to you.
Good day.
Nice to see you.
Yes, so nice to be here.
You had a good week?
Busy week. Exciting week in journalism. We've had the launch of the first standalone new national newspaper in about 30 years.
So we've the New Day. It is a New Day, apparently. Where do you want it there? That's called the New Day. Exciting or... You're not overexcited. 25 pence is a trial price, so interesting to see how much it's going to be, especially when the sun is 20p at the moment.
Yeah, I mean, I'd say the reaction so far has been fairly mixed. People think it's a little bit thin. There's not a huge amount in it. But people often are a bit perplexed by the new, and it is very new and very different. And
at a time, of course, when newspapers are either closing down or going digital, This is a brave move.
Yeah, well, very brave and, very interesting. So, I mean, the big things about it are that it's very unusually for a UK, or uniquely pretty much for a newspaper in this country, it gives you both sides of the argument, which is quite interesting. It's quite features-led, and I think it seems to be targeting mainly a sort of female audience. There's not much sport in there, but more features and more and a little bit more lifestyle stuff.
It's very magazine-y, isn't it? When you look inside there, you'll see it is very much the feel of a magazine inside.
But so we'll see. I wish it well. So it started off at free. It's gone to 25p. It will go up to 50p. So the big question is whether, people do quite like newspapers, I think, because Metro does really well. It's free. The Evening Standard in London does incredibly well. It's
and
free.
Very thick, isn't it?
Yeah, very thick, yeah. But it's whether people pay for it, because people are so used to getting stuff for free. So when it goes up to 50p, that'll be the real test in a couple of weeks' time.
It's a very light news week and an unfortunate week, I think, to actually launch a newspaper, perhaps.
Yeah, well,
maybe that's why it's so thin.
Maybe, but it's 40 pages, so that's what its target is, and it's actually not really news led; it's more features led. So I think it won't be too worried about the fact that they're not a huge amount of news this week.
So it's going to be a little bit like a daily magazine.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Okay, let's have a look at some stories now. And you want to go starting off with the New Day and a new community.
Yeah, so although we generally do local newspapers on this show, I thought this is a really good local story in our new national newspaper, which is a new community in Bute, which is a story which we covered a little while back about these Syrian refugees, which are going up to the Scottish island of Bute, I don't know how you pronounce it. And the New Day have got a really nice feature, actually. They've gone up to Bute to see how they're getting on, these Syrian refugees. And it's a completely different sort of story for a national newspaper. Normally, in the nationals, the stories about refugees are very hard news, aren't they? There are people dying, people massed on borders. This has actually followed it up and seeing how they're getting on. So we've got 26 Syrian families who've arrived in Bute, which has got a population of 6,500, so it's a tiny community to absorb these newcomers. It's no buzzing metropolis, the New Day says. It's 15 miles long and 4 miles wide and an hour-long ferry ride from the Scottish mainland. So, crikey, goodness knows what these, Syrians make of it,
So, are these people going to simulate? And I ask that question because I see that the primary school has had to order copies of We're Going on a Bear Hunt in Arabic.
Yeah.
So they should be learning English primarily rather than learning in their own language.
Well, I guess so, yeah. I guess maybe they're, the little mites just trying to give them something to read in their own language while they get on with it. So they're on a 5-year refugee visa. So I think the hope is, or the intention is, that when things have settled down, hopefully in Syria in 5 years, God willing, that place will have sorted itself out in 5 years' time, they'll be able to return back.
What is great is the locals have actually welcomed them with open arms, and a local shopkeeper said, I think it's great the refugees are here safe from conflict. It's a shame that more people don't have that attitude.
Yeah, I mean, and initially people were very concerned about it. Apparently the local paper, said, for God's sake, let's look after our own needy first. But now they're settled in. They've been there for a couple of months. They were the star guests at the dress rehearsal for the local pantomime. They were treated to Scottish country dancing display and reciprocated with a performance of their own traditional dance. And apparently the church hall opened up to donations of clothes and furniture and so on. And apparently the donations were piled so high that people were asked to stop giving. So it just goes to show how kind of, generous people are, really.
Okay, let's move on to the next story. This is actually from the South Coast and the Argus, and Fatboy Slim gives his backing to Hippodrome restoration dreams.
Yeah, but it's sort of the story about a bit of a sort of hidden gem for Brighton, actually. I mean, I've lived in this area for most of my life, and I didn't even know the Hippodrome existed.
Really?
No, I mean...
What have you been doing?
I don't know. I mean,
even the Beatles performed there?
Well, it's a bit before my time, isn't it? I mean, I think it's been a bingo hall, hasn't it, in more recent years.
And I think Ministry of Sound took it for a short while as well, before it actually closed down.
So now it's this enormous venue, sort of 900-seat theatre, basically from the era of variety, basically. Yeah? So, you know, Sammy Davis Jr. played there, Harry Houdini, even before your time.
Even he escaped.
And Laurel and Hardy played there, the Beatles and the Rolling Stones as well. But now it's empty, and Fatboy Slim's got behind a scheme to try and kind of... renovate it, which seems like a winning scheme to me. I mean, crikey, so much demand for live music now, isn't there?
Well, many would say, you know, it's great to keep a venue going, and people can have the right, you know, some great ideas, but you need to put money where your mouth is. If no one can afford to actually open that and run it as a theatre still, then it's going to have to go for something else. It's been empty for a long, long time. Many years now, in
fact. And they're looking at a huge amount of money. So it was £8 million just to kind of stabilise it. £13 million if they wanted to create it into a kind of new venue. Or the best option would be £30 million if they want to turn it into a sort of, a proper kind of theatre, which would be 1,500 capacity. So they'd have some really big shows there. But, you know, like you say, there's so many demands now on public money. They've got the West Pier in Brighton, which is sort of crumbling into the sea. There's the big new I-360 tower, which is partially funded by the council. So it's just like, how many things can people, you know, unless it's commercially sustainable, you have to wonder, you know, where the money's going to come from.
Now, I mean, there were a number of theatres and cinemas in Brighton at home. Nearly all have gone. You've got the Theatre Royal left as the main theatre, which has a lot of West End shows on the way through going to the West End. You've got the Dome,
yep.
Has two theatres, which are now closing for the next 2 or 3 years while they're being totally renovated.
Yep.
You've got the Sally Bennis Theatre, which is also closing soon for renovation.
Yes.
And you've got the Emporium. There's not much left. The Emporium is only an 80-seater.
Bit like newspapers, aren't they? Theatres.
You can't catch them online quite as easily. Okay, let's go to Hull now. I love Hull. It is Hull next, isn't it? Don't panic. Invasion of Dad's army. Doggers. Doggers? Just ridiculous. I was going to say Dodgers, but it is Doggers.
Yeah, it's a bit of a fun story here. So the Bridlington is where the new Dad's Army film is set. And it's... according to The Sun, a squadron of swingers have invaded the seaside location of the new Dad's Army film. I'm a bit confused, because I always thought Dad's Army was set in Bexhill in Sussex.
Really?
They're filming in Bridlington.
They called it Bridlington on Sea, didn't they, Dad's Army?
Okay. Warminster.
Yeah. Warminster.
So anyway, the Sun had this story, and the whole Daily Mail is doing a really good job of kind of hitting back on behalf of Bridlington, saying it's not a haven for swingers. So it's a good bit of fun. This councillor Cyril Marsberg, who's a former mayor, has taken it quite serious. He said, "It's ridiculous." I'll put a Northern accent on. "They're just trying to fill the paper with it. I've been here since 1968, and I've certainly not heard anything like this." Maybe he's not been invited to those sort of parties. But there's another councillor who's, Councillor Copsey, who's had a bit of fun. He said, "I think maybe some people have misinterpreted the parking signs."
Is this the right accent, by the way?
It does say park and ride, after all, which is a bit of fun. He says, "Anyone who gets naked in this weather is made of sterner stuff than I am. I'll give them that." So that's a bit of fun. And apparently what it's come from is that Bridlington, like Brighton, has a nudist beach. But the nudist beach has closed, possibly because Hull and the North Sea is probably not the best sort of beach to get completely naked on. I have never been there.
It's a very interesting place. There's other areas more interesting, but you have got... what's his name? John... what's it? To constituency, isn't it?
Yeah.
John Prescott.
That's right, yeah. It's not on the way to anywhere.
For many years.
You wouldn't go there, but maybe Dad's Army's going to put it on the map.
Well, it had a great fishing industry, like Grimsby, and it just went by the way. Mm. And they had to find lots of other ideas to keep the place going. Okay, all the villains escape justice. Anger as Stafford Hospital scandal boss is clear. This comes from the Midlands Express and Star.
Yeah, there's a good beefy bit of journalism here from the Express and Star, which is a paper we often come to. It's the UK's best-selling regional daily.
You're going to put a Midlands accent on it?
Based in Wolverhampton. That's a sort of Brummie accent. It may come on, I don't know, I can't predict it. But they've returned to this mid-staffs NHS scandal, which you remember from a few years ago, which was this mid-staffs NHS trust, which was being run woefully badly, and there were hundreds of premature deaths there. There's been a three-year review of this by five detectives looking at 200 patient deaths. And surprise, surprise, no one's going to get charged. You know, so there's 200 people died who basically shouldn't have, but, you know, no one at the hospital is being held to account.
That's happening all over the country. We're going to go for a very quick break now. You're watching the newspaper with me, Mike Mendoza, and Dominic Ponsford, back after the break. Welcome back to the newspapers. This is where we look at the regional newspapers in the country with me, Mike Mendoza, and Dominic Ponsford from Press Gazette. Let's go through some more stories. We've got an awful lot to go through today, and this one is from the Argus in Brighton. Daryl Rowe of Edinburgh, arrested by Sussex police, accused of putting sexual partners at risk of HIV by deliberately tampering with condoms.
Yeah, so interesting story, this, and a bit of risk-taking and brave local newspaper journalism, I would say. So the headline there, we have that man's name in it, not really a name to conjure with, but they put that name in that headline very for a very particular reason, which is basically that they got a press release a little while ago from Sussex Police saying that an individual who they didn't name was putting people's health at risk by tampering with condoms and putting his partners at risk, his sexual partners at risk of HIV deliberately. So there was an alert out. Sussex Police, all they said was, it's a young guy with a Scottish accent, which isn't much use to you, is it, if you're in one of his potential victims. So the Argus did some digging. They did some digging up in his native Scotland. They found out the guy's name. They put it to the police. The police still wouldn't confirm it. But the Argus thought, well, we think this is true, so we're going to take the risk on a libel point of view. We're going to name him. He can sue us if we want, but we think this is true. We're covered. But they also thought, you know, we need to tell our readers who this guy is. So they published it. Still, the police aren't saying anything. And the Argus basically wants to know, well, why aren't you confirming this guy's name? And what it comes down to is that police nowadays are extremely cautious about naming people who've just been arrested, because those are the national guidelines. And it's all down to data protection, la-la-la, you know, concern for people's, you know, privacy, etc. But, you know, in a case like this, which seems to be a clear case of sort of public health, where you're reasonably sure that this guy is, well, you know, up to no good, you know, surely we need to put that information out there.
I believe the police weren't happy that he was named, and the Argus also asked them the question why there was a delay of 18 days between the arrest and the public announcement.
Yeah, well, the police aren't happy because the police think their journalist job is basically to cut out their press releases and stick them in the newspaper every day. But, you know, the Argus takes a slightly different view of journalism and feels that they need to kind of, you know, hold people to account. And so the Argus have done a long piece on this, and they've asked Sussex Police some questions which haven't really been answered. And like you say, they ask, why was this guy arrested, then released on police bail when there's a definite risk to public health? Why did the police not name him? And why was there an 18-day... like you say, an 18-day delay in this guy being arrested and then putting out this warning. So anyone who comes into contact with him that 18 days is like, why didn't you tell me? You knew about this.
A number of people have come forward, apparently, since then.
You know, so I say, well done to the Argus for getting out there and causing some trouble and doing a good job, you know, for the public, I say.
OK, let's go to Derby now on the Telegraph there. Aston Hall investigation brought up at Prime Minister's questions.
Yeah, so this is another good bit of investigative journalism, this time from the Derby Telegraph. They've been investigating a care home, Aston Hall, and allegations going back to the 1960s and 70s about some terrible allegations of abuse there. And basically, the allegation is that a doctor there was carrying out experiments on children there and loading them up with drugs in order to control their behaviour. The Derby Telegraph has interviewed some of these alleged victims, including someone called Helen Cliff, who said a friend of hers took her own life because of abuse she suffered there. And she claims that she herself was tied down and experimented on. So all this has been brought to light by the Derby Telegraph. The local MP asked a question about this week at PMQs, Prime Minister's Questions, and David Cameron has got onto it. He said, you know, I'm very happy to give an assurance that he's going to look into this. They're very serious allegations, vital, the full facts are considered. So all this prompted by some local paper journalism, and it's now being mentioned in Parliament. So, you know, good stuff.
It's the thing you expect to see in a Hollywood movie, isn't it, really?
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Happening in real life. Okay, moving on to Wales now. This is Wales Online. This Cardiff cat went missing for 2 months and was found 200 miles away in England.
Well, this is going to be a Hollywood movie, I tell you. I mean, this cat, Oscar, he vanished from his home in Cardiff in December. And the owners, Danielle and Becky Spencer, were absolutely distraught about this. They said they didn't celebrate Christmas. They spent Christmas posting 500 flyers around Cardiff. And, you know, they were absolutely miserable. They'd completely given up on Oscar. They thought Oscar was, you know, no more. He'd used up his nine lives. And now he's turned up in Sidcup.
Was he chipped, by the way? Did they mention anyone?
Well, he was chipped, indeed. So he's a stray cat was spotted in Kent, which is 200 miles away from Cardiff. He was taken to a vet, which is some kind person has done that. The cat checked the vet checked the microchip, got all the details, phoned them up, and they drove 200 miles to Kent, and they've been reunited.
How lovely, nice story. It shows the importance of being chipped, actually, for any animal.
Exactly. Question is, though, how the hell did Oscar get there? So they looked at his paws. His paws didn't look like he'd been walking 200 miles up the M4. So they think the only possible answer is that he jumped into a van or something. But, you know, Oscar will never tell us, will he?
Well, he's catnapped.
Possibly, yeah.
Never know.
We'll never know.
Plymouth and Herald. Mum lucky to be alive after tumble dryer starts billowing smoke in Plymouth home. And this actually does follow on to another story, which is Exeter home badly damaged in fire involving tumble dryer. We're getting a lot of stories about this at the moment.
I know. Well, I've noticed this. I think we may be on something here. But the through my trawl of the local papers each week, I'm telling you, the tumble dryers are blowing up all over the UK. So, you know, we're getting two or three every week. And in some cases, people are dying or nearly dying. So in this case, the Plymouth Herald, this lady called Jodie Jeffrey, she said, you know, her Indesit dryer started billowing smoke weeks after she received a letter from Indesit saying there was a risk of fire. So she's like, oh, thanks very much. You sent me a letter about this. And, you know, she was lucky to be alive. She said, I rang them after I received the letter in January. They told me it was completely fine to keep using the dryer. But it wasn't, was it? You know, she nearly died. So, you know, if I'd sold someone a tumble dryer that was at risk of blowing up, I think I'd kind of drive round there and kind of pick it up, wouldn't you? I wouldn't just send them a letter saying, you know, keep an eye on that because it may blow up.
I think there's two or three makes that have been known in Indesit is one of them. Two or three makes have been known recently as the ones to be aware of.
Yeah, well, apparently, according to parent company Whirlpool, 5.3 million tumble dryers are affected by the fault. And they've warned owners not to leave the house or leave the dryer on when you're asleep, which isn't much use, is it, if you've got a load of damp clothes to get dry?
Yes, yeah, so I think it's tumble dryers and some freezers, I think, they've had some problems with recently as well. It's quite interesting. All of a sudden, after all these years, some sort of appliances are just catching fire.
Yeah, but I mean, it's absolutely bizarre that the company is not sorting this out. You know, they need to just go around there, take it on the chin, or whatever it costs. They're a massive company. Say, here's a new tumble dryer that's not going to blow up and kill you. I mean, that's what you expect, really, isn't it? They, you know, just sort of let them go.
Off to Cornwall and the Cornish Herald. Pictures: couple treated for rare sighting of humpback whale off Cornish coast.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's an amazing story, this. You remember a few years back, there was a little pilot whale went up the Thames, and it was... And that, like, that led the 10 o'clock news that night, you know, because it's in London, where all the news editors live. But this massive humpback whale has been spotted off Cornwall, and, you know, it's just the Cornish Herald which covers it, no-one else does. But it's, you know, it's a very rare occurrence in the UK for one of these sort of mammoth creatures to be spotted there. It was a couple who were just out for the walking the southwest coast path near Land's End, and they saw it. It's a 12 metre long sub-adult, apparently, and you know, they're very recognisable by their huge dorsal fin, apparently. So, you know, wonderful for them. And, you know, just amazing that you can see these creatures in the UK. And I wonder why more isn't made of it.
It's also unusual to see one on its own. They normally go around in crowds, don't they?
Yeah. Look, according to Marine Discovery, which is a sort of charity which does, I think, whale spotting or which does, a marine wildlife company, they said that they're getting more common, these sightings. They said 2015 has been a very good year for marine wildlife, the most sightings we've had in the southwest in 10 years, which is quite sort of encouraging, really. Apparently another one was spotted in Dartmouth not that long ago, and there's been another one that was spotted in Mount Bay in Cornwall. So how long before we see a humpback whale in Brighton? That would be good, wouldn't it?
We've already seen a few and you don't realise it.
Yeah, so it's quite a good sign, isn't it? I mean, and I looked into it, they're not actually that endangered humpbacks. There's a lot of them around. There's about 80,000, apparently. And it's nice to have a nice positive whale story after those poor sperm whales that all got stranded in Lincolnshire.
Course, yes.
Do you remember that?
Yeah. OK, we're off to Birmingham now and watch Flytippers caught dumping cities, beds, fridges and dead sheep in Aston Street.
Yeah, so this is a sort of quite a good visual story. This is what the Birmingham Mail have got. They've got the video here, and they've got, if you look at it, it's quite a grainy black and white, but it shows three scumbags, I would call them, pictured just dumping sheep carcasses and all sorts of rubbish onto a street in Birmingham. It's quite a busy street. There's cars going up and down, and they're doing it in the dead of night and just chucking all this rubbish, into the road, basically, for the council to sort out, which is, quite a big problem, really, isn't it? Fly tipping, and it's
happening everywhere. Yeah.
You know, I think it makes me angry. But the council basically knew this was a dodgy spot for it. They set up some surveillance cameras. They caught these guys in the act, and they banged them up, which is great stuff, I think.
Well done. That's all we've got time for today, I'm afraid. Thank you for your company. For me, Mike Mendoza and Dominic Ponsford. We'll see you again very, very soon. Thanks for your company. Bye for now.